Namaskar, Khurshed ji. Welcome to
Namaskar.
You have spoken at length about ancient India's scientific achievements and its scientific endeavors and how we were much ahead of the world in that time. So, could you share some of these with our viewers?
Well, there is so much, you know, we could go on for a few months. But you take any field of science, say astronomy. We knew that the earth was round because geography was called Bhugol.
Right.
Gol. Bhugol. We knew that the earth was moving around the sun, that earth was not stationary because earth is called Jagat, jiski gati hai. Right? If you look at the constellation Arundhati Vasishta, it is a tradition in South India that when people get married, they are supposed to go and look
right.
at that. Now, it might seem very strange, why should you go and look at that? But turns out that Arundhati Vasishta, which is just a faint blur in the sky, is actually a twin star system. And amazingly, the stars are not, so if this is Arundhati, Vasishta does not go around it. Or if this is Vasishta, Arundhati does not go around
right.
it, but they go around each other.
Wow.
And that is how the husband and wife should be, you know. That one is not the center and the other is, both are kind of center. So it is such an interesting thing that the twin star system, which is, I mean, I find it astounding that these people actually figured out that it's a twin star system and that they move in this way.
And also at a time when the telescope was not there.
Absolutely, there was no telescopes, at least we don't know about any.
Right.
So like that. Then just in Delhi here, over here, we have the Qutub Minar and next to that the Iron Pillar. Even with the horrible Delhi pollution, nothing has happened to that iron.
Yeah, it's
that is few thousand years old. It is rust proof. Today also we don't know how they have made it. With all the technology that we have got, yeah, today also we have no idea how this rust proof iron was created. We knew how to extract zinc, how to extract iron, we knew how to make alloys much before any other civilization in the world.
And also the fact that this was all indigenous knowledge and
totally.
Not just concentrated or not just with the literate people
yes.
but even the tribes
yes,
had
because,
this knowledge with them.
Some of these iron pillars, there are a few of them still standing in mm-hmm. India, are in remote tribal areas. So it was not that it was the knowledge of the prestigious few, it was
right.
a kind of a sabko pata hai, you know. Like that, if you look at Ayurveda, now Ayurveda is a system of medicine that has stood the test of time. 5, 6, 10,000 years old, we don't even know how much.
Right.
And even today, it is so relevant and so many people are now turning towards Ayurveda as alternative therapy. There are even instances and implements that we have seen that kind of show that ancient Indians knew how to perform complicated surgery.
Hmm.
Not simple surgery, complicated surgery. There is record that plastic surgery was done to alter the face. So if you look at like that, you know, our navigation systems were absolutely astounding. In fact, it is said that Vasco da Gama was accompanied by an Indian merchant.
Oh,
and
that's interesting.
And his ship was 1/10 the size of the Indian ship that that brought him to India. So it was a Gujarati actually, Mr. Patel.
Okay.
And this reference is there in Vasco da Gama's own journal.
Mm.
So the kind of knowledge that the ancients had, whether it is far in the skies, in the skies and the stars, or whether it is an atom, the speed of light has been measured by ancient Indian scientists to be 2,202 yojanas per half a nimisha.
Hmm.
Now, one nimisha is the time it takes to
blink your eye. Right.
And one yojana is approximately 14 kilometers. And this is almost the same as the modern speed of light, which is approximately 3 lakh kilometers per second.
Hmm.
So, how these people came to know the speed of light, how they measured it, matlab chakit kar deta.
Bilkul.
And what I firmly believe in is that one of the main contributors to this amazing scientific explosion that was this country is because all our scientists were saints.
Hmm.
हमारे सभी जो वैज्ञानिक थे सभी ऋषि थे. They were all meditators. They all knew spirituality. And I guess they knew that exploring the outside is science and exploring the inside is spirituality.
Do you think that spirituality is actually the basis of science when you say
absolutely.
This?
Absolutely. It is. Any great scientist will always be in wonder in creation. That is spirituality. Spirituality starts with wonder. So any great scientist, you take any amazing great scientist through the ages, they will be in awe of the universe. And that awe is the first step of spirituality, where you go into wonder and say, oh my God, how did this all happen? From where did it all come? And then, who am I? And what am I doing here? And what is my purpose? So diving inside, the adventure inside is spirituality. The adventure outside is science.
Wow.
And that's it.
So all these wonderful instances that you have quoted, what happens today is sometimes we look at our past and term it as jingoism. What do you say about it?
I say that you are not looking at the evidence that is staring straight in front of you. You know, if you say that Ram Setu does not exist, for example, you are denying the satellite images. If you say that the city of Krishna that is under the sea does not exist, it exists, go and check it out. So I feel that you are just simply denying the evidence that is staring straight in front of your face, and you are not really a scientist if you say that. See, science, what is science? Science is a method of explaining observed phenomena. Right? Something happens and we want to find out how it happened, why it happened. This is what is science. Right? Now, just because it does not fit into your scientific belief system, you cannot deny it. Because I cannot explain it, therefore it does not exist. This is the attitude that a few misguided scientists have taken. And I really don't know why. Because they are a blot on the name of science. You know, I myself hold a master's degree in mathematics from IIT Bombay.
Right.
And I have full respect for the scientific temper and the rigor and academia. But when academia denies something simply because it doesn't fit, that is where there is a problem. You know, when we do experiments, especially in labs, then we have got all these points which are around the curve, right? And then there is that one point which is somewhere out there. It's called an outlier. And most people simply ignore it.
Ignore it.
It does not matter. It is not fitting into the normal. But hey, the outliers are the ones who have shaped civilization.
Wow.
Right? It is not normal people who are kings and queens. It is not normal people who are the scientists and the explorers. It is the outliers who have done that. And if the normal starts tending towards the outlier, then this world is going to be a better place.
Right.
Right.
So when we talk about all these scientific developments, the scientific endeavors that were there in ancient India, we can also see a society which encouraged scientific thinking, and also where the education system was much beyond just rote learning. What do you think happened in the course of time? Where did we go wrong?
I think the British happened. And then the Mughals happened. And all these things happened, and somewhere we lost the joy of learning. Today, when people go to school or when they go to learn, you know, you ask, I have dealt with thousands and thousands of young people all over the world as an Art of Living teacher in teaching the youth programs of the Art of Living. We've dealt with thousands and thousands of them. And if I ask them, why are you doing engineering or why are you studying medicine? To get a job.
To get a job.
Or to get a wife. This is such a pathetic reason to study.
Yes, right? It is.
At that time, nobody went to university or college to get a job. They went for the sheer exuberance of learning, of celebration of knowledge. Today, forget about the students, very few professors also do this. You know, the whole thing has become a race for getting good marks. And it really doesn't matter whether you know the subject or not. You know, when I ask people, what is the derivative of sin x? Cos x. What is the derivative? No answer. They don't know the concepts, they don't know the fundamentals. Mm. And when they don't know this, then we are churning out the educated unemployable, which is very sad. Mm. So, my mantra for this is, I say study for knowledge, not for marks.
So, right? I think it's the right time we should talk about your book, Ready, Study, Go.
Yes. So, Ready, Study, Go is a set of anecdotes, tips and techniques to use your brain the way it's supposed to be used. Mm. We've got 100 billion neurons in our brain. These 100 billion neurons have 2000 to 10,000 dendrites, hair-like structures coming out, which interact with each other in more ways than the number of elementary particles in the universe. So we've got a super advanced organic computer in our head, but it didn't come with a user manual. So when we can find out, figure out how to actually use our brain the way it's supposed to be used, then magic happens. And these techniques are simple techniques. I'll share one with you, for example. Mm. You know, Indian parents especially, they want their child to sit and study for hours. I know my parents did. Yeah? Do ghanta usne padhai nahi ki, matlab usne padhai nahi ki. Isn't it? Now, it is hardcore scientific fact that most human beings cannot focus for more than 20 minutes to half an hour. Mm. This has not percolated into the education system. 20 minutes to half an hour is the maximum a person can sit and study and focus. After that, the mind goes for a walk. It is waste of time sitting for 2 hours. If only this one little change can happen, that lectures be made only half an hour, not 1 hour, 1.5 hours, because the rest of the 1 hour, nobody is listening.
Sure.
Right? These are the little changes that we have talked about in Ready, Study, Go. And believe me, it was the techniques that I have talked about in that are the reason why I cleared IIT. Are the reason why now so many students all over the country and a few all over the world have been studying and have been getting amazing, amazing results. Mm. I want to share only one experience of one person who wrote an email to me. He said he cleared 16 backlogs in one shot.
Wow.
I was like, what? 16 backlogs in one shot? And he had written out the names of the subjects. So I told him, give me more details. Each subject he had failed more than 3 to 5 times. And in one shot he cleared all 16. He said, I owe it only to your book. I just followed the techniques in your book and bam, I managed to clear. One of the girls in Delhi, a 9th standard student, she had always been consistently failing maths. She got full marks in maths.
Wow.
So people have got amazing, amazing transformational stories that they have communicated with us. And it is very gratifying to know that we have been able to bring out change in the
way
people
study. What amazing case studies they would make. First, to understand why did they fail in all these subjects when they had their potential, and what was the, you know, what was that little thing which brought that tremendous change in their lives?
Just the ability to use the brain. You know, otherwise it's like looking for a black cat in a dark room which is not there. But when you put the light on, then everything is so clear. So the Ready, Study, Go book and our Study Sutras workshop that we teach, it turns the light on and it makes studying enjoyable, efficient, effective. And by the way, it is not only for students, it is even for working professionals, because all of us are studying something or the other all the time.
Right.
So the Study Sutras work whether you are solving partial differential equations or whether you are learning to bake a cake. It's the same principle.
Today, we are accused as a society of a society which does not have a scientific temperament. So do you agree with that? What would you say?
By and large, I don't think so. I think Indians by nature are very explorer at heart. I think we have explored more than the rest of the world. And it depends on what you mean by science and what do you mean by scientific temper. The science that I have understood, which is method of explaining observed phenomena, which is doing experiments and getting the same result consistently. If this is science, I think we are great scientists. There are some people who call something else that they do science.
What is technology of spirituality?
How spirituality works. It is very scientific. Spirituality has consistent observable results. If you follow certain steps, you will be transported to a certain space of consciousness, which now can be measured through MRI machines. In fact, there was a very interesting research that I was reading the other day, where they took meditating people who have been meditating for a few years, they hooked up MRIs to their brains, and they found that certain parts of the brain, like the hippocampus, the prefrontal cortex, actually have become bigger. Physically, the brain has changed from a non-meditator. Now, this really intrigued the scientists, and they wanted to find out how long it would take for this change to happen. So they brought in a bunch of people who had never meditated in life. They taught them meditation, and then they monitored them, and the brain changes started in as little as 2 months, less than 60 days. Physical changes measurable through MRI machines happened in less than 60 days. So it, according to me, there is a technology there that brings about this very physical change in the brain, right? And figuring out that technology is what the ancient rishis and modern day gurus like Sri Sri Ravi Shankar ji have unraveled for all of us. Fortunately, unfortunately, a lot of our scriptures are written in such a way that they are very difficult to decode. It requires an enlightened master to bring the chavi so that we all can understand and enjoy that what was very old to make it contemporary today.
Shifting the focus a bit, do you think that today the conflict that we see in the society is a result of the fact that we have actually drifted away from nature?
Absolutely. 100% we have drifted away from nature, we have drifted away from our roots, we have started denying what is obvious. It's unfortunate, but what is good is there is a comeback. More people are going towards Ayurveda, more people are looking at alternative therapies, more people are looking at greener constructions, doing rainwater harvesting, all the things that the ancients used to do are now slowly making
coming
a comeback.
Back. Because this is my personal experience. When I work in my garden, plant a tree, and when I touch soil, you know, the experience that it gives me, it somehow, you know, encourages me to be a better human being.
Absolutely.
That connect, I think, somewhere is missing.
Absolutely.
And probably this is the reason for
Absolutely.
All the, you know,
going away from nature and going away from our nature. You know, some time ago, this India Against Corruption movement had started.
Right.
That's where Arvind Kejriwal, Kiran Bedi, all these people came and talked. Of course, inspiration Gurudev. He had only one little sentence to say. Would you take a bribe from your own brother?
You would never do that.
From your own mother, from your father, from your sister, from your best friend. Would you take a bribe? Hum rishwat kisse lete? जो अपना नहीं है, है कि नहीं?
बिल्कुल.
यदि लोग में अपनापन आ जाएगा तो रिश्वत कौन किससे लेगा?
तुझे सिंपल कुटुंबकम की बात आज हम भूल चुके हैं. हाँ. या हमें फिर से याद करने की जरूरत है?
Absolutely.
शायद यही सबका मूल था.
इतना ही है कि वासुदेव कुटुंबकम, द होल वर्ल्ड इज माय फैमिली. व्हेन द होल वर्ल्ड इज माय फैमिली, फ्रॉम होम विल आई टेक ब्राइब? आई कैन नॉट टेक ब्राइब फ्रॉम माय सिस्टर और माय ब्रदर.
वेरी
ट्रू. इट इज जस्ट coming back to nature and coming back to our nature, which is all encompassing. Sab hamare hai, sab apne hai. Bas.
You write a blog, you are also working on a book, you run a cafe. How did all this start?
Spirituality is what that upholds the spirit, that makes you feel good. You're feeling good, I'm feeling good, I'm sure the people watching are feeling good. We are doing spirituality, right? Cooking for me is alchemy. You know, you take two ingredients which taste awful and put them together and they taste amazing.
Wonderful.
Isn't that magic?
It is.
It's like you are in Harry Potter land.
And right? This is a magic that you also transport to others.
Exactly.
When they have it.
Exactly.
And that's the beauty of it.
Right. And I I'm a Parsi, so when I did the Art of Living course, I became totally vegetarian. So I was the only vegetarian in a non-veg house. So it was my duty and responsibility to convert them to vegetarian. So I had to become a good cook. Right? And then I just enjoy my time in the kitchen, because like I said, you know, you add this, you add that, and suddenly you have something miraculous in front of you.
So do you love fusion cooking?
Absolutely. I love all sorts of food. My only condition is it should taste good.
Wow. So the next question, this should have been the first question ideally, but I'm putting it at the end because I want my viewers to know about your story. Like you said that you are a graduate from the IIT. So what led you to take the alternate path and not follow the path that probably your peers had taken, you know, not getting into the corporate grill?
What I started thinking at that time of my life was, I started questioning what is it that I really want? Mujhe actually kya chahiye? This was even much before I did the Art of Living course. And I think I took some 4, 5, 6 days off and really sat and thought, what do I want? What is it that I really want in my life? And the answer came, I want to be happy. I'm not allergic to money. I would love to have happiness and money, but money would be secondary.
Right.
And when I looked at all my peers, as you said, people who had graduated, they had got their dollar jobs, they had got their MBAs, whatever. The one thing that I didn't see in their faces was a smile. And so I decided that this is not what I'm going to do. I never even sat for campus interview placements. I never even sat for that. And around that time, Art of Living came into my life. And I had the great fortune of meeting Gurudev, Sri Sri Ravi Shankarji. And here I saw this 5 foot nothing person smiling, giggling, laughing, and people around him smiling, giggling, laughing. I said, hey man, this is what I want to be. And so it was just an obvious thing to do, that if I want to be happy, if that is the purpose of my life, if I want to be happy, make other people happy, then I need to be with a person who is happy and making other people happy, right? Otherwise, it would be contraindicatory to what I seriously, sincerely want. And at that time, 1991, 92, nobody knew Art of Living, nobody knew Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. So people were telling me, you are mad. You have got a master's degree in maths and you are going around the world teaching people how to breathe. What's the matter with you? And I said, no, I may be mad, but I am happy. What about you? And now, 25 years later, the same people tell me, how did you know it would be so big? I said, I didn't know. I was only very clear that I didn't want to do what everybody was doing, because if you do what everybody is doing, you become like everybody.
Very true.
And I wanted to be that dot, the outlier, right?
So your piece of advice to our viewers.
Be happy, make others happy. Keep it simple.
Thank you. Thank you very much for being here with us on our show.
Absolutely wonderful being with you also. Thanks for inviting me.